Greetings. Thank you, Brother George, for the following thought-provoking message. It is claimed Allah is greater and knows everything. It is also claimed Muhammad was illiterate and could not write. In the cave, when Muhammad received his first revelation from Allah through Angel Gabriel, Muhammad was asked to write it down. Then Muhammad said, "I cannot write." And then he was squeezed and asked to recite. Now, simple logic says, if Allah knows everything, why did he ask Muhammad to write it down when he could not write? It seems Allah does not know everything. And I think that is a very valid point which all who hear the tale of Muhammad should consider. I'm sure a handful of excuses can rapidly be invented and imagined by Islam's defenders. First and foremost, what difference does that make? I would call that the "I don't care" gambit, because one must care enough to think about it. Second, Allah wanted to imply Muhammad was not educated enough to invent Islam. But that is dangerously close to calling Muhammad too stupid. Third, ignore logic and just assert, "See, Allah decided thus and so." That works to fool Muslims who play "Allah says," but means nothing to anyone else. Basically, George's point appeals to rational believers, those who wish to follow a deity who makes sense. But as I was thinking about his point, I realized another aspect to consider. If you or I were approached by a stranger, how would you or I react if the stranger started talking to us? We'd answer politely, right? But what if they told us things about ourselves? How would we respond then? Really, there are two cases before us today. In case one, the stranger tells us to do something we know we cannot do. Just like the spirit in the cave who Muhammad thought was a demon. But in case two, the stranger tells us something no one could know but us. In such a case, the person exhibits real knowledge they should not have. We might consider that divine knowledge, like this. John 4:3. He left Judea and went away again into Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. And Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, being wearied from his journey, was sitting thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Therefore the Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask me for a drink, since I am a Samaritan woman?" For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." Let's keep it real, G. That sounds like bragging. "If you knew who it is that says to you..." She said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get your living water?" Evidently, the implication of greatness did not impress her. She said, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with." In fact, listen to her next comeback. "You are not greater than our father Jacob, are you, who gave us the well and drank of it himself and his sons and his cattle?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life." Now this gets her attention. The fountain of eternal life. Hear what she says next. The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water, so I will not be thirsty, nor come all the way here to draw." Bless her heart, she still thinks Jesus is talking about physical water. But Jesus still has not yet exhibited case two behavior. He said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered and said, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You have correctly said, 'I have no husband.' For you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. This you have said truly." And there you go. Jesus just told her things no one could know. Now, watch how she reacts. The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." Bam! Can you see the difference? A real prophet reveals divine knowledge, which has immediate impact. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you people say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. I'm fascinated that suddenly she is talking spiritual or at least religious things. She brings up, "Where should we worship? You Jews say Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, an hour is coming when neither in this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews." And that one statement reveals why Satan wants to stamp out Jews. Salvation comes from the Jews. Salvation comes from the covenant of Abraham with God. And if you call yourself Christian and hate Israel or the Jewish people, you are a sadly confused and uninformed individual. But an hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For such people the Father seeks to be His worshipers. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, He who is called Christ. When that one comes, He will declare all things to us." Now, I just want you to grip your seat a little tighter. We think Jesus was only sent to the lost sheep of Israel. Well, look what Jesus said directly to this woman. Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am He." Allow that to sink in for a moment. Jesus, with complete clarity, speaks to a Samaritan and non-Jew. "I who speak to you am He. I am the Messiah you have read about." From there, the woman runs and tells all she knows. So the woman left her water pot and went into the city and said to the men, "Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?" Other translations read, "Is this not the Christ?" So, which approach do you think manifests God's wisdom to impress and to save? You may cling to excuses that some hidden plan benefits from requiring an impossible act. Or you may seriously consider which approach would convince you the stranger spoke for God. Divine knowledge or impossible demand? May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.